Hello, everyone, and thank you for being here. I see there are a lot of people, and I believe from different parts of the world. So, thank you for being here, and I hope that you and your family are safe in those times of this coronavirus crisis. And we are very grateful that you were making it today to this webinar organized from the Crowd Modeling Community of Practice about the model WOFOST. We are before just Before starting, just let's see how technology is going to work today. I hope that we won't suffer any problem, but due to the house confinement, it can happen that the internet connection will go bad. Just please chat, write in the chat that you can listen me and see me properly, and also let us know. Let us know if there is something wrong. In case the connection is lost, just please wait 3 5 minutes because we will do our best to get the connection again. So all of you are muted. If you have any questions or any comments, so please the comments you can type it on the chat. You will see like the chat window. If you have some questions, please type them in the question and answer place in the Zoom. We have already received some questions before this webinar, and I hope that we will have time to reply most of the questions. So first, I would like to introduce the panelists, and just let us know if there is something is not working. So alert. Oops, sorry, alert. I wrote your name. Wrote alert. We have alert
no
and
problem.
Hendrik. We have Alert and Hendrik from Wageningen University, and they're going to present WOFOST, the model WOFOST. First, Hendrik is going to do a presentation, and in this presentation, some of the questions that you already sent us will be answered. And then Alert is going to do a Jupyter notebook training, like on-hands training. So let's see if this is going to work. So I'm going to throw it up to you, Hendrik, for starting you with the presentation. And thank you, everyone. First, thank you, the speakers, for agreeing and doing the presentation. And thank you for being here.
Thanks, Annabelle, for the introduction. So I hope you can all see the presentation. Okay, then, well, first of all, thanks. I would like to thank the CGR and specifically the platform for the big data on agriculture to have us here presenting WOFOST. I'm Hendrik Bogart. I'm working for the Wageningen University and Research. I'm working here for a long time. I also work for a long time with crop models, but I'm not so much a crop developer, but more a person, a scientist that uses these models in all kinds of studies, specifically in regional studies for larger areas. I will do this webinar together with Alert de Wit. Alert will introduce himself later when he starts the demonstration with Jupyter Notebooks. And I would like to start the presentation now. So WOFOST is a simulation model for quantitative analysis of the growth of a crop and the production of annual crops. So in my presentation, I will I will first introduce the WOFOST model, then I tell a little bit about the model processes, some of the principles, and also pay a little bit of attention to how you can apply the model at the regional scale. We will have some examples where WOFOST has been applied, so the applications. I will introduce the portal where you can have access to WOFOST and different implementations. The implementations themselves, we will shortly introduce them. Alert will give the demonstration, and then we also have some concluding remarks. So I might give those concluding remarks before Alert starts the demonstration. So first, a brief introduction to the WOFOST model. So WOFOST stands for World Food Studies. And as I already told you, it's a tool to do a quantitative analysis of the growth of the crop and the production of the crop for different production levels. I will explain more about those production levels in the next slide. It's an like most of these models, crop models, it's a mechanistic model, dynamic, with time steps of one day. I think one specific thing about the Wolfast model is it's a multi-crop model, which means that it is designed to simulate a large range of different crop types using a single code base. So you don't have to touch the code to simulate other crops. It's completely in the crop parametrization. So it's external to the model. So the Wolfast model can simulate different cereals. It was actually designed for more the cereal type of crop, but it can also be applied for root crops like potatoes, sugar beets, sunflower, all kinds of different crops. And another important thing to mention is the strict approach of doing separation of the state and the rates. I will explain more about that in also one of the slides. The main model processes in Wolfast are the phenological development. So Wolfast does not have a fixed crop cycle length, but we simulate the timing of the different crop stages like flowering, maturity. Another important model process is the leaf development and how the light is intercepted over the leaf canopy and during the day. Of course, the assimilation, so converting the intercepted light into material, plant material, and the respiration, so the maintenance of the plant. The transpiration, partitioning of the dry matter over different organs, and also water balance, specifically for if you look at the water limited yield levels. You need to have some idea about the soil moisture and if there is a drought stress. I will tell a little more about these model processes on this slide. So on this slide on the right, you see the different components. Of course, weather is very important. So there's a specific weather module that is driving the crop growth model. It it's about, about temperature, radiation, rainfall. In the middle, you see the green part, which is actually the crop model with the different processes, elements. If you look in the green center, you see the phenological development. So that's what I just explained, that we simulate the phenological development from day to day, from the emergence up till maturity. An important other part is the effect of drought in the model. So we calculate the potential transpiration rate, but we look at the available soil moisture in the soil. And if that's too low, we reduce the transpiration rate to the actual transpiration rate. Sorry, I just have to take a water. Right in the middle, the most important part of the model is interception of the light through the leaf canopy. That steers the assimilation, so converting the light into the sugars that then is converted into plant material, dry matter, and part of the sugars is being used to maintain the crop. The dry material is partitioned over different organs. You see that below. In the roots, the stems, the storage organs, so the grains or the root crops, the potato, and the leaves. And there's an important feedback. So in the beginning of the crop, the leaf canopy is almost, there are almost no leaves. So the leaf area is very small, the lie below. So in the beginning, in the first stage, much of the dry matter is partitioned to the leaves. The leaves canopy will increase, so we intercept more light, and we have some kind of exponential growth. That continues from day to day till the canopy is closed, and then we have kind of linear growth. And later in the crop cycle, when you have more the reproductive stage, when you when the grains are formed, the assimilation rate, the capacity will decrease. And this is kind of the cycle, the whole cycle of the crop growth that is simulated through the crop model. So cannot tell you much more about it now because of the time. You see on the left some references to a peer-reviewed paper, 25 years of Ovalst, which is a nice paper to read. You will find more about also about the processes, but also how Ovalst has been applied. And there's also an Ovalst system description, but that was recently updated, and that's a quite extensive description of all the processes that have been modeled in Ovalst. On the top left, you see a table that explains the different parameters that are being used in the crop growth model Ovalst. And some in the total column, you see the number of parameters. And so you can, for instance, see that the leaf growth, senescence, and assimilation, that part of these processes in Ovalst have been more detailed, have more parameters compared to processes like stem formation, for instance, that are more simple in the model. So that's about the model processes in Ovalst. That was a brief introduction. One of the important applications of Ovalst is to explore different production levels. So what kind of production can you reach if you do everything optimal in your management and if you have sufficient nutrients and sufficient water? So we define these different production levels. So the first level that we simulate with Ovalst is what we call the potential production level. So it's only limited by radiation, temperature, carbon dioxide concentration, so the climate, the governing climate, and the plant characteristics and the planting date. Then we have a next level. That's what we call the water-limited level or rain-fed level. So here we don't have full irrigation. We assume that the only water we have comes from the rainfall. So that's but everything. All the other factors are optimal, like sufficient nutrients, optimal management by the farmer. Then there is another production level that's limited by nutrients. But that's not really, or we have two tastes, I can say, in the Ovalst model that we have distributed for a long time. We have the Krefts model, that's not a dynamic simulation, but it's kind of a post-processing step, looking at the basic supply of nutrients by the soil, and what kind of level you can then reach if all the rest is optimal. We do that for two levels, the potential level and the water limited level. And then from those potential levels, you can also look at the demand of these micro nutrients like NPK. And then, yeah, you can also see how much nutrients you would need to close the gap. So this basic supply is then the supply that the soil can deliver. So without any fertilizer or manure. Then, but maybe Alex can tell more about that one later when he's doing the demonstration. We have the experimental model that simulates dynamically the plant uptake of the macronutrients NPK. So that's there. But one of the questions was about the soil nutrients, and that's not really simulated in Ovalst. There are other models that can do that. Even in our organizations, we have other models that do the simulations of nutrients and the leaching of nutrients to soil and groundwater. But that is a different topic. It's more an environmental issue, how much soil nutrients are being lost to the environment and create environmental problems. But that's not part of Ovalst. Then going towards the last level, that's what we call the actual level, that's not simulated in Ovalst. Well, your level, your production level is further reduced by weeds, pests, and diseases. And then you arrive at the actual yield. So that's one of the important principles of Ovalst, the different production levels. As I already told you, another important principle in Ovalst that we take very seriously is how we work with the states and the rate calculations. So to ensure a correct simulation, the different types of calculations, so the integration of your variables, the driving variables, your rate calculations, these are strictly separated. So first, all the states of the variables are updated. Then the rates of changes, including the driving variables coming from the weather, like rainfall, etc. These are calculated, the rates of change, and then the day number is increased and we update the states again. But what we want to avoid is that if you do not do this in the right way, there's the risk that some of the rates in your calculations for a certain day will pertain to the states of the current day, whereas others might pertain to states from the previous time step. And that's something you would really like to avoid. So that's an important thing that we take very seriously in the implementations of BOFOST. Something about the applications for in space. So BOFOST is a one-dimensional simulation model, so without any reference to geographic scale. So the size of a region to which BOFOST can be applied is limited, because we would like to affect certain aggregation effects by the non-linear response of the crop model. So the crop model has many non-linear responses, and we would like to have we don't like that the input data is first aggregated and that we then apply the model. That will actually give you different results than if you first split your space into very small units and apply the model for all these different units and do the aggregation afterwards. If both approaches will deliver different results, and we prefer to first split the space into small regions that we can assume that are constant in terms of weather, crop, and soil management. So we first, and there's an example, a schematic example here for a grid number one and different soil mapping units that we then do an overlay in GIS so that you obtain the different elementary mapping units. And those elementary mapping units then are the spatial units that we assume that the data of those units are constant and do not vary over space. And we first apply the model for all those different units, and then we do the aggregation towards a region. If you would do it in a different way, so first aggregate all your input data towards the region and then apply BOFOST, your results will be different. And yeah, it's better to do the first thing, to apply BOFOST on the different spatial units that are internally or can be assumed constant. So that, and we have quite some experience in applying BOFOST in for, you know, larger regions. We follow this approach. Now some examples where we use BOFOST. So one interesting example, I would say, is the Mars crop yield forecasting system. So this is a system we are running for a long time for the European Commission. Their BOFOST is the backbone of that system. So the Mars crop yield forecasting system provides timely, independent, and scientifically relevant information on the crop development and the growth of different crops over Europe. It gives information on short-term effects of meteor events, so weather events on crops. And it's also the input for seasonal yield forecast of some key crops over Europe: cereals, oilseed crops, protein crops, sugar beets, potatoes, rice, both at the complete EU level, but also at the member state level. So this system, so the regional application of BOFOST was developed by us in the 90s. It actually has been acknowledged by the parliament as the official system to do crop monitoring and crop yield forecasting over Europe. And we are running this system operationally since 2000. There's a link on this slide, and I assume that we will distribute this presentation afterwards, so you can come check this this URL and find more about this. There's an on this slide, I give some more explanation about the monitoring system. Actually, it has three levels, so the level one in blue, that's the weather monitoring level, where we do all things around weather data, collect weather data, do spatial temporal scaling of the data so that you have a complete weather data set over Europe at a fine spatial scale from 75 till today on a daily level. Then we can do anomaly things like, is it warmer or colder than normal, etc. This is an important input for the second level, the green part here, WOFOST. So it's feeding into WOFOST for different spatial units over Europe, but it also, WOFOST needs the information about the soil to simulate the soil moisture and see if the soil moisture is below a critical level, so that we have to reduce the assimilation rate. But also information about crop calendars, when does the crop start, ends. So the whole crop parameterization is there for different regions over Europe. So there we apply WOFOST for many different units, spatial units over Europe. And then you can do analysis like if the crop is developing quicker or faster than normal or slower than normal, is there more or less biomass than normal. And this information, this simulation of WOFOST, but also the information about the weather is also used in a second, in a third level. So the purple level, level three, where we do a statistical forecast of different crops over Europe for different member states. So more you can find through that URL. On the right, you see an example of a bulletin that is then being produced through this system. So at the European Commission, there are many analysts that are digesting all this information of data of the weather, the crop simulation by WOFOST, and they turn it into maps. So they, for instance, there's a map of areas over Europe where it's more critical concerning droughts or rain and how that is affecting the crop growth. And also a little table with forecasts of different commodities. Okay, another example is the Global Yield Cap Atlas. So the Global Yield Cap Atlas, here we explore possibilities for extra production and extra intensification under full irrigation, assuming that there's irrigation infrastructure there, and under rain-fed conditions for major crops, food crops over the world. So this is important, for instance, to make investments for agricultural R&D, to study intensification pathways. So where in the world can we intensify cropping systems more? Where is the difference between the actual yield and the potential yield? If a farmer is doing everything correctly and there is sufficient nutrients, where can we find areas where we can increase the production a lot? So where the actual yield is still low and where the production, the potential production can be is relatively high. So this is an international initiative, and one important thing is that we work with local economists and also local data as much as possible. There's a standard protocol for assessing yield potential, water limited yield potential, and the yield gaps. So it's illustrated by this graph on the right. And we work with the best available local data. So we work with weather station data, and for those weather stations, we look around those weather stations for the most dominant cropping systems and the most dominant soils. And for each of the combinations, we apply the WOFOST model. And so we assess the potential yield levels, and we compare that with the actual yield levels for the cropping systems around that weather station. And there's a protocol to upscale the results for those weather stations towards countries, regions and countries. And one important thing is there that we just need sufficient number of weather stations to do a reliable aggregation towards those regions and countries. So that's another example where WOFOST is being used. This is a result of that GIGA initiative. So this is a yield gap of rain-fed maize in sub-Saharan Africa. So the green colors show very small yield gaps, while the red and dark red colors show the big yield gaps. So for instance, in Ethiopia, you see in Western Ethiopia, areas where you can increase the production quite substantially, but that means that you have to invest in R&D, in supporting the farmers, in getting more nutrients into that area, etc. Fertilizer. There's another example. I should be brief about this one, but you can find it through the portal that I will introduce within next minute. Here, what you can do is you can run RowFost online. So you will select a crop. There are only a few, like maize, and then year, and you select a location. And for that combination of crop, year, and location, you can just run the model, and we will use the most relevant data that we can find. It's being listed here what kind of data we use. We run the model and then we show some results, time series, like here, time series of storage organs, leaves, and stems. And on the right, some summary table of the final output of that run, the final yield, the maturity date, etc. It's just the first version. We would like to add export functionality here, but more important, we would like to add some more interaction with the user, that the user can also enter its own planting date for that specific location and its own crop cycle length, because then it becomes much more local relevant. I think the weather data is quite okay in this application, and maybe also the soil data is still a bit coarse maybe, but specifically the crop data, that's more coarse and more regionalized. And here, if we can add something that the user can enter its own planting date and its own crop cycle length, then it becomes even more interesting. But here you can run RowFost online. So just announced that we have a portal where you can get access to RowFost. On top you see the URL, you see the landing page, and in the red box you see the different sections. So the principles of RowFost, the technical implementations that I will show you in a second. Documentation, support, and the online RowFost that I just announced, that I just explained. So about documentations, there's quite some documentations around RowFost. So the reference publications, something around regional yield forecasting, I explained, like the Mars project, around climate change, crop yield analysis, like the global yield cap atlas, using satellite data to assimilate in your crop growth model. There are some examples. Alad knows much more about that one. Sensitivity analysis of RowFost, and the last one, some selected papers of RowFost being used for certain crops. So the last one, these papers are grouped around certain crops like wheat and barley. And so you can find more when you consult that portal. You have different implementations of RowFost. Right from the beginning, Wageningen, we distributed the models, including all the source code. That means that there was a large take-up of RowFost in the application domain, but it also led to many implementations of RowFost, and also to redundancy, complex maintenance of the model, issues in reproducing results, and it also hampers the new developments. So a few years ago, we decided to improve on that. So currently we have three different lines at our institute. So that's the old RowFost Control Center RowFost, the Fortran version, a new one, and the Python version. So the second one, this is the Java version, and the last one is the Python version. Alad will tell more about the Python version. But important to note is that all these implementations have extensively been tested against the reference data set with many different simulation data sets or input data sets to verify the correct implementation of RowFost. This is the original implementation of RowFost, so coded in Fortran 77. It's still available, you can download it, but it's not actively maintained anymore. Nice thing is that it has a very rich graphical user interface with a nice thing with what we call rerun feature. So that means, for instance, that you can play with some parameters, like here in the middle, the TSUM1 parameter. So how the parameter that determines how much temperature some you need to come from emergence to flowering. And we made a run with parameter value 800, 900, and 1000 temperature degrees. And on the right, then you see that that results in different runs. You see the different lines, and on the y-axis you see the development states, and on the x-axis you see the days, and you see that the run, the red run, just takes longer because the temperature sum is higher. So that's just an example of this rerun facility, which is quite nice in that old user interface. Then we also noted that our crop model implementations are a bit outdated also from IT perspective. We have nowadays much more data coming available, like Copernicus and Sentinel remote sensing data. So that means that you can apply your model on a much finer scale. And at the same time, we also have more cloud solutions. So that means that our crop model, there are new requirements for such model. And just for instance, more requirements towards the interface, and also to more easily scale to secure the performance of the model. So therefore, we started a new initiative, what we call Wageningen Integrated System Simulator. It's a Java-based, lightweight, continuous simulation framework for agroecological modeling with a daily time step. In this framework, you can build your own crop growth model. It offers modularization, control, speed. I cannot tell much about it now. But one thing is important, and which is maybe unique for this model framework, is the shared state approach. That means that the states are being dealt with in a specific object and not in the modules that are calculating, doing the assimilation or doing the phenological development. It's in a separate object, and that makes it very easy to do all kind of querying on the states. What is the average biomass over the run, even after the simulation. You can also easily override state variables without touching the code. You can stop the simulation, resume the simulation. You can easily do unit conversions. So this is an interesting framework. More information can be obtained through Daniel van Kraling, our colleague. And so this framework has been used to implement Wolfost again in this Java-based framework. So we have a Fortran-based old Wolfos version. We have a Wolfos version implemented in this Java framework that we use for large applications. And we have the Python version. And the Python version will be presented by Alad through a Jupyter Notebook demonstration. Before Alad takes over, there's the concluding remarks. So I hope through this presentation you know more about Wolfost and that there is a clear suite of Wolfost implementations, that we have a portal where you can find more information about Wolfost. There's even a Wolfost online that you can play with Wolfost online. So this WIS thing, so this new framework seems also interesting to explore, to specifically for new developments, if you want to do something with cloud computing, then that might be an interesting thing. On the scientific side, of course, not only our group, but also with colleagues from the plant science group, we are working on scientific improvements of Wolfost. So recently we worked on winterkill. We would like to add another water balance, a multi-layer water balance to the model. What I already explained is about the dynamic modeling of nutrients. We're working on new parametrizations, even on real field experiments in our area in the Netherlands. Grass modeling, and also adding more functionality processing around heat stress and drought stress. So that's what I would like to want to present about Wolfost. So I propose that now Alad takes over to demonstrate the Python-based Wolfost through the Jupyter Notebooks. So then I stop sharing.
Okay. thank you, Hendrik, for this extensive presentation on WoWPost. Yes, well, my name is Alard Wit. I'm also working at Wageningen Environmental Research for a long time. I'm one of the basically developers and maintainers of the WoWPost model, so I'm really with my hands into the code of the model itself. And I want to demonstrate you some basically on how to run WoWPost with this Python based version of WoWPost, and we'll be using the Jupyter notebooks to do that. What I'm going to show you is basically all on the web. Can you see my screen, Hendrik, now?
Yeah, I can see your screen.
Okay, yes, we can see your screen.
Ah, great. So everything I will show you is already on the web. It's on my GitHub site, which is this one. And you see all the Jupyter notebooks which are used here. Well, there are 9 at the moment. I will only show 3 of them because we don't have enough time. So the first one I will show you is this one about getting started. This is the basic one that will introduce how it works in BCJ WoWPost. For anyone not familiar with these Jupyter notebooks, basically Jupyter notebooks consist of cells, and each cell can have 2 modes. They can either be in what they call annotation mode, which is this one, for example. If you double click on this one, you see that it will actually just provide you with formatting possibilities for text. And if you push shift enter, it will actually execute the cell and it will render the cell in your browser. And the other option is this one, which is actually a code cell. And this one has actually Python code in it. And if I press shift enter, it will actually execute this code on the background. You see it with the star, and now it is done. And you see that it prints some of the outputs on the screen. So this notebook was filled with Python 3.7.5 and basically version 5.4.2. Well, this is basically how these Jupyter notebooks work. And I will go through a couple of those notebooks just to give you a demonstration. Now, wait a moment. What I'll show you is first is basically to how start WoWPost from the internal demonstration database, which is inside PCC, which is like this one. We're not bothering with the how to get the inputs yet for running it. We'll just start it. And what you will have now is basically a WoWPost object, which has been instantiated into the memory of the PC. And it's just waiting for you to do anything. It's there, but it's not doing anything yet. And you can ask it to start simulating by calling run. Now, when we call run just once, it just simulates one day. Well, it's not so useful often, so you can also ask it to simulate a couple of days. In this case, you can say run days is 10. So it will proceed with running 10 days of the simulation. And what you can do is now is you can query the object for any of the variables which are there. For example, we can query the variable TAGP, which is total above ground production, which shows now that we have 208 kilograms per hectare of dry mass simulated. But you can also ask for the leaf area index, for example, which shows that it's still very small. Or we can ask for the soil moisture, still relatively high, 0.31, and so on. Everything, every state or rate variable which is in the system can be queried like this. Now let's see if we run another 50 days of simulation and ask for the leaf area index. Now you see that the leaf area index has now been increased a lot, up to 5, so that the simulation is running. Now, often you just want to run the simulation until the end of the growing season. And to do that, you can start, you can run till terminate. And now the simulation has finalized until the harvest or the maturity or whatever you have specified in the agro management solution. And you can again query for the leaf area index. Now, in this case, it may be surprising to see that the leaf area index is none. And that is actually deliberately. When you run until the end of the simulation, until the end of the crop cycle, basically your crop is gone out of system memory because it doesn't exist anymore. So your leaf area index is now non-existing because the crop object is not there anymore. So it disprints none. Now, if you want to get the output from the simulation, you can ask for it. Well, so you can get the output. Now it with the get output query, you get the simulation output. And the easiest thing to work with that is to turn it into a so-called PANDAS data frame. And this basically presents you all the output from the simulation run starting on the 1st of January until the 31st of May, where we reach development stage 2, which means maturity in this case. It's a serial crop. You also have a summary output, where you can ask for a summary output, you get summary output, and now it shows you that it reached maturity indeed on the 31st of May, with a total biomass of 18 tons per hectare, yield of 8.7 tons per hectare, and a maximum leaf area index of 6.2. And finally, if you want to run a graph of it, you can easily generate it with Matplotlib, Pandas in this case. You see here the graph output of leaf area index and crop biomass. Okay, that is the basic principle of how things work in PCC. But you're probably interested in understanding how you can run something with your own data. So for that, we go to the second one, which is running PCC with your own, well, this is custom input data. And what you should understand is that if you want to run a model like Lowfrost, you always need at least three inputs. First of all, you need your model parameters that parameterize all your components. You need your driving variables, which is basically weather data. And finally, you need your agro management. You need to specify what is happening on the field, what farm activities are going on there. Now, let's have a look at all these components. First, we need to import all the relevant modules again. Now, parameters are consisting again of different things. First of all, we have our crop parameters. In this case, for example, we're going to read it using something called Cabo file reader, which reads a file from the file system. In this case, it's under data, it's on crop, it's here, this sugar beet 0601.cab file, and basically looks like it. This is an old style Lowfrost crop parameter file. So let's read it. Then we have the same for soil data. And we have something called site data, site parameters, I should say. And these are parameters which are not strictly soil, not strictly crop related, but are really site related. And for example, an important one is the initial amount of soil moisture, water availability at the start of your simulation. Another one could be atmospheric CO2 concentration. And here you see a different couple of these site parameters. Now, what we're going to do now is pack all those parameters into one object. And that's basically what this parameter provider object is doing. And it's encapsulating your crop, your soil, and your site parameters into one object structure. Okay, the next one is the agro management. The agro management is a structure which showed you, well, basically defines what's going to happen on the fields. And this is basically the structure that it requires. This is a very simple example, but you can have a lot more complex examples where the simulation starts on the 1st of January 2006. We have a sugar beet crop, which starts on emergence on the 5th of April 2006. It runs until harvest on the 20th of October 2006 and with a maximum of 300 days. In this simple example, we don't have any state events or timed events. For example, you can use state events or timed events to schedule management tasks like irrigation or nutrient application, these kind of things. Well, finally, weather data. There are a lot of options to actually provide weather data to the system. In this case, we will simply be using an Excel file. So let's read it. The Excel file is also here under the data folder that comes with the GitHub repository. For example, it looks like this. This is a weather file in Excel with weather from Wageningen. Fairly simple structure. So you have basically a header with some information about the site and then daily values for all the different variables over here. And you see here from the output that it has actually read this Excel file with data starting on the January 2004 up till December 2008 with zero missing days. Now, actually, starting Wolfhorst, you first need to import it. So there's a system called pcc.models, and you can import Wolfhorst 71 water limited production free drainage from that module. And basically, then you can start it with feeding it with the parameters, your weather data provider, and your AGCO management info. Well, let's start it. The fact is that out of this pcc.models, you can not only import Wolfhorst, but there are actually multiple models already available that you can import. So PCC is also a kind of framework that you can use to implement models. For example, you could also import the Lintel model, Lintel 3, or there is also an FAO, Water Requirement Satisfaction Index model available there. And that works basically in the same way. So how you use it is identical. So the model is now instantiated. We're gonna run it till, say, Wolfhorst run till terminate. So it's now running, it gives the results again from my pandas data frame, and we can generate the output again. So here you see again your development stage, your total above ground production, leaf-air index, and this is your soil moisture. Okay. What time is it? Do we have still some time, Annabelle?
I think just 1 more minute, because then we will have a little bit of time for the questions.
Okay.
Is it okay, 1 minute more?
Yes. Well, one, but then I'm just going to show you this notebook. You can also get it from my GitHub site and run it yourselves. This is an excellent example where we basically do a kind of a, I know it's this one on the 4, where we demonstrate how to run multiple simulations in batch with PCC Wolfhorst, where you use multiple crop files, multiple soil files, multiple sites, AGCO management for different crops, and then have a kind of simulation loop where you basically run in sequence all these different simulations, and finally you export everything to Excel output in order to be able to analyze the results. Now, there are quite some notebooks already. For example, here's one on advanced AGCO management, where you can demonstrate you how to do irrigation scheduling, nutrient scheduling. You can also run crop rotations. So in the examples I showed you now, you basically run one crop in a row. Every simulation is one crop individually, but you can also sequence multiple crops in one simulation. There's some advanced notebooks here, which is on data assimilation. There's one on parameter optimization, and I'm working on one on sensitivity analysis. That will be also be coming onto this GitHub site. For one thing I would like to share with you is that actually yesterday I received an email from Robert Heijmans, who provided me with a new implementation of Wolfhorst in R. So if you go to this website, you will find the R implementation of Wolfhorst, and Robert has been testing this implementation also against our reference data set. Okay, Annabelle, I think that's what I wanted to show.
So thank you very much, Adar. So then we are going to move to the questions. We received some questions and some came out here. So let's see, probably we can try to extend the webinar 5-10 minutes, let's see. And the questions that will not be addressed, we will try to answer them afterwards. The first question, so it came from Azam Lashkari and Mohsen Edalat, is why are there a large number of crop models and what is the difference between WOFOS, DSAT or APSIM? So I think this question goes to Allard.
Yes, that question goes indeed to me. Well, I should first say that DSAT itself or APSIM itself is not a crop model. It's basically also a framework for which contains different crop models. So for example, the proper comparison would be say WOFOS versus Ceres maize or something like that. Why are there different models? Because there have been different modeling groups working on implementing models on their own in different parts of the world. They use sometimes different approaches. For example, the Ceres models are, I would say, a bit more simple than WOFOS, and they are a little bit more targeted towards practitioners, while WOFOS originally has been more developed from a, let's say, an urge to understand the biophysics. So many models in DSAT have been involved with very practical applications in mind, while WOFOS comes from a more theoretical CTDVIT group of approach. Maybe Hendrik, do you agree with me on that?
Yes, yeah, I agree. Don't have to add anything.
So let's move to the next questions. Yeah. A lot of questions about soils came that I think Hendrik is going to answer some of them. You know, it's like, does WOFOS simulate soil salinity? Does it consider ion toxicity effect on crop production? And also whether WOFOS is useful for both saline area or drought area?
Yes. Well, can be rather short on this one. So WOFOS does not simulate soil salinity. And so that's just not included in the model. The WOFOS as it is now is more useful or is targeted to explore drought stress. So that's not in the model. We have different water balances, more simple one, and I just explained that we also are implementing a multi-layer water balance, so that is mimicking the fate of water in the soil, and well, that's all around drought stress, but not around salinity. But Allard, you would.
Well, I know that SWAP. There's another model in Wageningen which is called SWAP, and that's basically a very detailed soil hydrology model, including soiled and solute transport, that does include soil salt, and it also includes WOFOS. There is an interaction between salt and WOFOS in SWAP, but that doesn't include ion toxicity.
Yeah, and I deliberately did not talk too much about the WOFOS implementation in SWAP.
Yes.
Because I wanted to focus on the what we now call the more official implementations of WOFOS that have been tested against the reference data set. While the WOFOS implementation SWAP, we still have a few questions there. So that, okay.
Yeah.
Maybe I can also then take the other question, the next one, on how we define the root zone moisture content. Is that based on different soil depths? Well, I just explained that. So we have different implementations of the water balances. In that scheme I presented, actually the water balance approach was actually a bit outside of the WOFOS model. You can link different water balances to the WOFOS model. Yeah, make different crop model solutions. So we have a very simple one, in a single bucket. So that has only a maximum rooting depth, and that's then based on the interpretation of soil maps. And we have a multi-layer one, and then the different soil depths are based on a concept that you first start with more finer layers, and towards deeper rooting depth, you will define a bit more coarser layers, but that's related to the concept of that water balance model. But the soil data comes from soil maps or soil grids, like our institute here in Wageningen, the International Soil Reference Institute, ISRIC, has also gridded soil maps.
How do you calibrate WOFOS? What reference data? What model output? That's from Konrad Jakusz.
I can start, and maybe Alad, you can.
Yes.
First of all, on the portal, there is a kind of document that explains how you should calibrate WOFOS in a kind of stepwise fashion. So that's one thing. Usually we first look at the phenology and calibrate the phenology in the correct way so that you have a correct crop cycle length and also a correct ratio between the vegetative phase and the reproductive phase. So that's important. And then we look at other parameters that we also then need to calibrate. But for the first step to calibrate phenology, so what I just explained, the crop cycle length and the ratio between the vegetative and the reproductive phase, you need observations, and that's always the difficulty, to find sufficient observations. So if you do it for only one location, one experiment, you probably have a lot of data around that experiment that you can use. But if you do it in a regional application, you have to deal with what's available, and that could be regional crop calendars, or it could be some real observations that you then use in a kind of calibration approach of that region. Maybe Alad, you can explain a bit more or add.
I know that in the WOFOS 25 years paper that you also refer to in your presentation, there is a kind of strategy outlined for calibration of WOFOS, which are the parameters to look at, which are the output variables to have a detailed look at. The problem always with calibrations on different crops is that it's often very, like you said, data dependent and often site dependent on what you need to adjust. So it is very hard to actually provide really kind of strict guidelines on how to calibrate the model. But in the paper and in some of the resources we provide on the WOFOS website, there are some generic guidelines on doing it. And there's, for example, also one Jupyter notebook which shows you how to do a kind of optimization on observed leaf area index profile by adjusting some parameters. That could also be helpful.
The next question is from Jan van Delden. So I assume it is WOFOS is a deterministic model. Do the predictions come with confidence bands?
No. Standard, the since it's a deterministic model, it doesn't provide confidence bands in itself, but you can always rerun the model with perturbed inputs in order to generate these confidence bands, of course.
Can this model be used to simulate greenhouse gases emission from different management practices?
No, that is not included in WOFOS.
Is it planned that it will be included or not?
No. Because that's not what we are targeting with WOFOS. Then you get really into another type of models. Do we have, what do you get, Hendrik? More animal type of models that we also have in Wageningen?
Yeah, I'm thinking about the work that our colleague Wim de Vries is doing.
Exactly.
But these are not, that are even other models. We have to look it up, and if we will... I think, Annabel, we will also provide the answers, huh?
Yeah, exactly. Maybe let's do two more questions or two or three more questions, and the rest of the questions we will share with the recording. Another question that came from Leonard Rusinambozzi, that he was also in other webinars we have done, and also Moss and Edalat, they asked, is there any possibility to add new crops, such as perennial crops or medicinal plants to WOFOS?
Yes, you can add additional crops, but perennials is a difficult one because it's almost really geared towards annual crops. And one of the difficulties with perennials is always that the management of those perennials is often very important in understanding their cycles. Although, I mean, some of the, let's say, the biophysics related to CO2 assimilation would be similar, for example, that, for example, if you take orchards or grapevines, there the pruning is very important, which determines your actual your yield levels, and that's not included in low frost.
One question from Maxim Poltoradev that it came in the question and answer. So my question concerns more the practical aspect of using WOFOS to predict seasonal yields. How heavy is the parameterization of the model? What are the minimum requirements for crop and soil parameterization?
Well, the minimum requirements, I would say, is that you need information on your cycle length. So you need to know your you need to know your crop calendar, and basically on that information you can tune the phenological parameters in low frost. And then what we usually do is we run the model on these with the change parameters for a long time series, let's say 20 years, and based on that we analyze how the model response is, and if the model response is let's say reasonable in terms of what we know about the crop without any, let's say, true field data. For example, let's say if your leaf vary index goes up to 10, which is totally unrealistic for that particular crop, then you have to change some additional parameters. And there are some guidelines in that WOFOS 25 years paper where we do that. So then you have to adapt the crop cycle length. That's the first thing. And then you have to check your model simulation results, whether the results are plausible, I would say. And if they're not, you need to do some additional changes. And that's basically the minimum set of requirements that we have for setting up a WOFOST model for a given area. When it comes to soil, the minimum requirement is basically soil water holding capacity and rootable depth.
Unfortunately, there is no more time for answers. We will try to reply all the answers that we have not been able to reply due to time limitations. We will share this with you. I would like that you keep engaged in other webinars we are going to do. You can follow us in social media like LinkedIn, Twitter, and our updates via the newsletter or in our web page. We have done a webinar about DSAT, about AppSim, and this webinar about WOFOS. We would like to thank all of you for being here, and thank you to the speakers for the extra time you gave us and for answering so many questions. I don't know if Hendrik and Ella, you have something to say?
Not specifically, just thank you for organizing this and for inviting us to give this webinar. It was nice to do.
Yeah, for me the same. It was a pleasure to present on WOFOST, and thanks for the attention, and hope to keep in contact. We will answer all these questions, and
thank you again to all of you for this time. So keep safe, keep healthy, and I hope you and your families stay healthy, and all the best for you all.